Mercedes, the Delta Air, the Ferrari, the Stadio di Parma, Wode, Professor Tony Watkins, who's an economist, Mr. Mutala Dai, the Chief Executive Officer of Zimbabwe Bank, that represents the Bankers Association. Executive is back home. I welcome you, Mr. Schumer. I also, of course, must welcome and acknowledge Keith Mawoyo, our director of CMO. And I want to start off from where the director of CMO left it. He spoke of a new economic trajectory. The wife was a math teacher. And she always used to talk about trajectory. And when I asked her to explain, she says it's all to do about the path that is followed by a story or a missile when you throw it. And that the way you throw it will tell you whether the story will go very far or very near. Now, I want to say that we can use this example to say if you are throwing a stone, we must first sketch out from where the stone is being thrown. And also, we must be mindful of where it will land. I think that is what a trajectory is all about. Where are we as an economy? And I will briefly basically talk about it, but I am not quite keen to dwell too much on it, because I think all of us are very much aware of where we are in terms of our economy. We are in a low business and investor confidence mode, but not anymore. The director of CMO has pointed out the mood after the new political dispensation is overwhelming, and we hope that it can be sustained. Our difficulties or our problems are basically how to manage expectations. The expectations that sometimes they are too high, and they don't appreciate that all good things must come after hard work. And that they don't happen as an event. It's a process. So I want to implant in your minds that we start a journey which is a long overhaul, and that is a process, and that it requires hard work. We should run away from short-termism, which I think is an illness which affects most Zimbabweans, short-termism. We must look the long-term and take a long-term view. And the long-term view and vision is that we must have a growing economy, 7 to 8% annually for 10 to 15 years. That is what will get us out of our situation. That should be in the context of a politically stable, democratic country. Politically stable and democratic country. So we need prosperity. We need political stability to underpin that sustained growth. Some of our challenges we know in adequate foreign exchange, which is necessary, of course, to support our infrastructure. And I can go on and sustain the fiscal deficits, current account deficits, debt overhang, low business competitiveness, low production across almost all economic sectors. That is where we are. So as we throw our stone, let's understand where we are throwing it from what position. That is the position which I just described. High levels of unemployment, almost a collapsed manufacturing sector. I see some of the companies here who are manufacturing. I don't know what they are doing now. Now, rise in informal sector activities, and I have already mentioned the foreign currency shortages, cash shortages. That is where we are as we throw our stone to define a new economic trajectory to prosperity, sustained growth, and increased production. My apologies. Let me deal with this issue. Now, we have already started taking very serious steps towards achieving our vision. The President's inauguration on the 24th of November set the tone for a new economic order. I followed it up on the 7th of December with the, I think it's been described the boldest budget statement that has come our way for quite a long time. And the State of the Nation address by His Excellency the President. It sets the tone, and we are projecting, as we, for this year, we are projecting a growth of 4.5%. This is up from 3.7%, which we, I'm confident, will be achieved last year, largely contributed by mining, agriculture, and the electricity sectors. Just an issue on the growth. We had a dispute with the IMF on the growth. We put it at 3.7 ourselves. They put it at 1.7 or thereabouts. In August, they revised it to 2.7%. But we have remained stuck to our projection of 3.7%, and I'm quite confident this will be achieved. We have had a problem, of course, of inflation. But even there, we have had a disagreement with the IMF, where we projected it at around 3% last year, that is. And they were talking about 8% or so. And of course, the thing to say about inflation is to say that it's not price rises, but the rate of price rises. I think even the economists will acknowledge that. And when we have average the inflation for the year, we think that it will be around 3%. Not too bad when you consider that we were in a deflation. I think the deflation is the worst thing. It means there are no activities taking place, and unlike what we are beginning to witness, a lot of economic activity, certainly, but we need to underpin it by real production. We, in the banking sector, I'm happy Mr. Mtanagai is representing the Bankers Association is here. We, the sector has been very stable, and this has been on the back of adequate capitalization, and we have also cleaned their balance sheets through taking over collateralized debt through ZAMCO, which is a subsidiary of the Reserve Bank. So, as we go forward, I mentioned the three pronouncements, the inauguration speech, the budget statement, the State of the Nation address by His Excellency on the 20th December last year. Now, the critical pillars that are underpinning this reform agenda are primarily the need to build market confidence. A lot of what we are experiencing is market confidence. It's all reflected, for instance, in the fact that the money is not circulating. People take money and put it in their pockets. It's all to do with market confidence. Again, confidence, we enjoy the confidence of our trading partners, elsewhere on the continent and in the global community. We also need to underpin our reform agenda with discipline in the management of our public finances and the economy as a whole. Again, we started taking concrete steps to address the issues of fiscal deficit, to address the issues of production, addressing the issues of increasing exports. We also need to underpin our reform agenda by policy consistency, clarity, credibility, and predictability. And I think that so far, the trajectory is very clear, and the consistency is now coming back right across the board, and largely driven by the thrust of the president in this regard. It's very clear where he wants to take us, it's very clear where he wants to take the country economically. And his major focus is on the economy. Of course, we will not forget the politics, but we'll spend more time now talking about the economy and what needs to be done to get our economy right. We have already started on the issues of confidence. We have already started addressing the issues to do with cash shortages, including foreign exchange generation. We have already started addressing issues of the unsustainable fiscal budget deficit. For instance, we are cutting down on a lot of expenditure, and we are going to make modest savings. I'm aware, of course, that addressing the wage bill is not an easy issue, not just in central government, but even in private sector companies. It's not an easy issue. And the way we are proposing to address it eventually is a two-pronged approach: rationalizing expenditure, achieving efficiency, rationalizing recruitment, freezing recruitment, but above all, increasing the cake, so that eventually the expenditure on wages will find its proper proportion within a bigger and growing economy. We are also addressing the issues of corruption and indiscipline. We are going to engage in a very serious manner in international engagement, not just the economic engagement that we have been undertaking over the past years, but also normalizing political relations with those countries with estranged relationships with us. And I'm talking here, trying to normalize relations with the European Union, political that is, the United States, and the United Kingdom. We consider normalizing relations with the United Kingdom as the key, because our problems are bilateral between us and the UK. And I'm very confident now that I think we'll start the first steps towards that normalization. At least there is willingness on both sides to put on the table the issues that have divided us over the past years. We are also creating an investor-friendly business environment. The amendments that we are achieved, or we are going to achieve today, tomorrow, in fact, are presenting the budget, defending the budget. The amendments that we did to the digitization law were to create an environment which is conducive to foreign direct investment, but also conducive to domestic investment. I need always to underline the point that any economy must be dominated by locals. To the tune in normal countries, to the tune of 80-90%, is the foreign investment will only constitute about 10%. So the answer to our economic ills does not lie necessarily only with foreign investment. Foreign investment comes to complement domestic investment. And so it's a challenge that I put to all local investors, domestic investors. We must also, as a way of building market confidence, ensure that the 2018 harmonized elections are credit. What this means is they must be free and violence free. And as government, we are determined to ensure that those elections are free and violent free. As far as we are concerned, the ruling party, we don't need to beat anyone to win the elections. We believe that we have a cocktail of policies that can take this country forward without having to beat anyone. So I am very confident that elections which are coming will be free and fair, and I don't think that there will be any problem. So far, the voter registration exercise has gone exceedingly well. We funded it to ourselves and well funded, and I believe that up to now, they've registered already something like 4.9 million voters, and we extended that voter registration exercise from the 5th of January, I think, to the 12th of February. So, as far as we are concerned, we have a good basis for free and fair elections come this year. We need credible elections so that we do not suffer any further setbacks in normalizing our relationships with other countries. Cash shortages, we are addressing those issues. Of course, what I think I need to point out on this issue is that the future lies in electronic transactions, and that is for any country. But there will always be a room for cash-based transactions, which will constitute normally about 10 to 15% of total value of transactions. But what we need to address as we go forward is to achieve a more efficient circulation of currency, including, of course, addressing leakages. Currently, there is no efficient circulation of currency. Currently, there is in the market cash up to 16% in the economy. But because it's not coming back to Mr. Tandagai, it becomes a real problem. I believe there is beginning to be some improvement in that regard. Now, so we therefore need to increase production and hence exports, which is why we have an array of incentives to support the goose that is laying the golden egg, to support the exporters right across the board, the mining sector, horticulture, tobacco, agriculture, anyone who is into exports, we are supporting. For instance, we are increasing this season the support we are giving in terms of export bonus to the 5 to 12.5%. Into gold miners, we have supported them, and this is why now the small scale gold miners are now exceeded the production levels by the primary producer, the big producers. We now were able to achieve 24.8 metric tons last year. And the 13 or so metric tons is coming from artisanal mines. So we will continue to give them the support that I think they deserve. The issue of exports, of course, continues to be a problem. The fact that 86% of our exports are coming from mining and tobacco only is not a very good state of affairs. We need to diversify the range of items that we export, and we are achieving this through a diversity of incentives. Fiscal incentives, we are targeting, like I've said, horticulture, tourism, and manufacturing outside mining and tobacco. We are also seeking to plug leakages in exports and export receipts. We are seeking to remove a lot of the bureaucratic procedures around inhibiting exports. Those are going to go. And we found that there is a lot of multiple and fragmented export documentation points we are going to streamline all that. We have also, I'm sure you're aware, pronounced an amnesty on those who have externalized money, and we want them, no questions asked, we just want them to honor so that we can proceed and move forward. Public enterprises reform. And when I say public enterprises reform, I'm including here state-owned enterprises and local authorities. Because what we found is that the ills affecting central government, central government, are the same ills affecting local authorities and state-owned enterprises. Sometimes the structure of the budget is wrong, the efficiency leaves a lot to be desired, and those are issues that we are going to be addressing. Essentially, in this area of state enterprises, we will certainly not hesitate to close down technical insolvent parasitoes which are not strategic. I emphasize which are not strategic. We are encouraging forging joint venture public-private partnerships arrangements for some of those parasitoes. And I need to point out that the legal framework is now in place through the Joint Ventures Act. And we've set up, as required by that Act, a joint ventures unit in my ministry to drive and to promote joint venture relationships. Anyone with any idea of a joint venture is free to approach the joint venture. First, you approach the line ministry, and then you can then come to approach the joint venture unit, which encompasses representatives from line ministries so that decisions can be taken quickly. The driving force is basically the OPC, that is Office of the President and Cabinet, my ministry, and the SERA, that is the State Enterprises Restructuring Agency. And we are now in the process of working out on the modalities for implementing the proposals on state enterprises reform. A position audit report with specific recommendations is being drafted, and that I will be presenting to Cabinet for approval. The full program for these reforms that is addressing state enterprises should be expected to be in place by the end of March this year. I need to point out that there has been something circulating to the effect that I've already decided which parasitoes to privatize and so on. That is not correct. I have not yet. Any such decision is collective, not individual. And as I pointed out, we are doing first an audit report, and then we will make presentations to Cabinet as to which parasitoes will be dealt in which manner. It is only then that we'll be able to report to the public as to what exactly the policy position is. On corruption, we are going to capacitate all agents which are mandated with the fight against corruption, such as the Zimbabwe Anti-Corruption Commission, the Zimbabwe Republic Police, the Prosecuting Authority, the Judiciary. All those are instruments in the fight against corruption, and they need to be well resourced so that they can carry out their mandate. We are also going to promote in the financial services sector digitalization. This is to make it more difficult for people to engage in dishonest and corrupt practices. We are also going to establish a toll-free line to facilitate reporting of any cases of corruption to the Office of the President and Cabinet, over and above the administrative levels. When we have a toll-free, we have established one at Zimbabwe. The people who look at that data which is given need to be very mature people, because there is also a tendency sometimes for people, evil people, to attack and target the very people who are stopping corruption. Then they raise false allegations against them and so on. So there is always need on how to handle this information with care. Already the cleansing has begun targeting unlawful and illegitimate deals in transactions, money laundering practices, externalization of foreign currency, and underground foreign exchange dealings, among other corrupt activities. I have already said something about re-engagement and international cooperation. Those with respect to the debt arrears clearance strategy. We are on course on political re-engagement. I have already made reference to that. And to assist and facilitate that political re-engagement, we are saying we are committed to protecting the firms which are under bail, and will do our best to expedite payment of compensation of any land that other people which may have been taken. Some of that land was parceled out to A1 farmers, and it will be difficult to reverse. But we are under obligation to pay compensation, and those are issues that we are clearly looking at, and we are going to expedite. We are also in the area of indigenization. I'm sure my pronouncements in the budget were very clear. We are saying in the extractive sector, the only firms or sectors are diamonds and platinum, which will have to comply with the 5149 indigenization law. The rest of the extractive sector, anyone is free to come in without any questions asked about ownership. This is to encourage foreign direct investment. We are saying there is a sector which will be reserved for our citizens, but those already in it, we are not chasing them away. We are not a xenophobic country. What we just require from them is that they own up and register, and they can carry on their participation in our reserve sector. But even in the reserve sector, we are also saying any foreign investor can enter upon a special dispensation granted by government. And if the proposed business will create more employment for our people, will afford opportunities for the transfer of skills and technology for the benefit of the people of Zimbabwe, and if the proposed investment into the reserve sector by the foreigner promotes the creation of sustainable value chains, and also meets the prescribed socially and economically desirable objectives. We are also, and the Minister of Industry and Commerce and Enterprise Development is formulating a local content policy. This is basically to strengthen and broaden and deepen interlinkages for local procurement and supply of goods and services, leading to the development of linkages between industries and other sectors of the economy. We want the development of new industries and increased capacity utilization in the existing ones. So a framework, local content policy framework, is being worked up, and this will be done, I'm sure, in the not too distant future. What are our priorities as government? We are giving top priority to support agriculture, largely because it is the major source of livelihood for a good percentage of our population, about 70 or so percent, but also because it has linkages to other sectors of the economy. I believe that with the support to agriculture, it will help to drive the resuscitation of our industry. In this case, the agro-processing industries in the first instance. But we want to support agriculture big time. My budget went out of its way to suggest that every year we are aiming to develop 200 hectares to irrigation per administrative district. We have something like 63 administrative districts. And this will be a program on course for the next 10 years. We want to reach a situation where we will never have a food deficit situation in this country. Currently, we are food self-sufficient. And we may, depending on the outcome of this season, we may also consider even exporting some of our maize. We, in order to underpin agriculture, we have to unlock the value from the land that we acquired under the reform in order to enhance agricultural production. And to do so, we must secure security of tenure. So we have provided resources. As you know, the farms were cut up into small pieces. We now need to fix those new boundaries so that we don't have continuing and continuous disputes on boundaries. This will facilitate the issuance of A1 permits and 99 year leases for A2 farmers. And I'm happy to announce that we now have found common ground with the Bankers Association over the acceptability of 99 year leases in respect of tradability and transferability in the event that there is default with those who may have gained credit on the back of those 99 leases. We are also, as I have pointed out before, evaluating compensation for PIPA farms and also for those former farm owners. And I need to say that in terms of evaluation of the farms, we have completed National Central, National and West. We have completed, I think, Mat North and South, and we are halfway through Marshes. And next will be Manika and Mashino and Midlands. But the bulk of the commercial farms were basically in Marsh Central, Marsh West, Marsh East. And we believe that that exercise is going on very, very, very well. Now, we want to promote and we believe that our economy will be on the back of private sector growth, driven growth. And the following are some of the measures that are being implemented by government in order to promote private sector growth. The ease and cost of doing business. In this regard, with respect to the cost, there should be, in the next week or so, a major step will take to reduce the cost of doing business or to affect one of the factors in the cost of doing business. As you are aware, the legislation to establish special economic zones is in place, the board is in place, was appointed. They are in the process now of interviewing the chief executive officer, and I believe that the recommendations by the panel will be considered very soon. We are also, in many of the ways that we are doing, we are seeking to attract foreign direct investment. This is why the President will be going to Davos in Switzerland for the World Economic Forum. This is basically to explain to the global players, we are not in the global economy, but we need that platform to be able to explain that we are serious. We want to re-enter the global economy, and we are serious about it, and we'll be able to explain what we are doing, what our policies are, and what we are going to do, including, of course, explaining the current challenges that we are facing, and how they can be resolved. And I'm looking forward to that visit. I'll be in the delegation of the President to the World Economic Forum, and I believe that the meetings will be very fruitful and productive. Let me just conclude and say our aim is to achieve over time sustainable growth 7-8% or sustainable over 10 to 15 years continuously. In the context of a politically stable and democratic country, we strongly believe that raising agricultural productivity, restoring market confidence, international engagement, infrastructure development, that is roads, energy, water, irrigation, and railways, and access to sustainable sources of long-term finance. This is what we need in the re-engagement, because we need lines of credit to support the productive sectors. And that is currently what we do need. And I believe that we should, if we succeed in the re-engagement, we should be able to kiss our problems away. So this will set, in my view, a solid foundation for sustainable economic development. And I'm happy to say that in the area of infrastructure, we have not been able to fund, some of it we have been able to fund it from the budget. For instance, we are currently undertaking 3 major dams, Causeway, on the boundary in Manikaland in Marshes, Marwanyat in Boera, Waishangan in Matinoth. We finished the Tobem course after many years, but again from budgetary resources. Although a dam which had been initially costed at something like 80, 90 million, ended up costing us 300 million. So it shows the need to mobilize resources sufficiently so that things can be done timely. On the energy, as you are aware, Kariba South first phase has been completed and is now contributing an additional 150 megawatts into the national grid. Another 150 will come on stream by end of March from Kariba South. We have been talking and discussing with the Zambians about Batoka, and I think that serious efforts are being done. We are updating the feasibility study, and I believe that we should have no problem about finding funding for that project, because it's very viable. It will come bring the cheapest electricity that this country has not been able to experience. And all told, we are looking at 1,200 megawatts on either side of the border, which is a major contribution to energy. Railways, already something is almost near fruition with respect to capitalizing and entering into an arrangement with or resuscitating the railway system. So all told, I am very optimistic about the future of this country, economic future of this country. The trajectory is defining the correct path, and it will go quite far. Thank you very much.
Are you tired of keeping up the headlines but never get the full story? Or you simply just can't afford to part away with that hard-earned dollar? Not a problem. Rely on 2C3 Chat to bring you all the latest information and news of the day, on the day, at zero cost, accessible from your mobile phone. It's news delivered via WhatsApp. What is more convenient than reading your favorite newspaper from a smartphone wherever you are, any time of the day? It's digital, it's eco-friendly, and it's access made easier. Sign up for your daily free 263 chat e-paper today. It's simple, quick, and easy. Just WhatsApp 263 chat e-paper to plus 263-777-028-169 to subscribe for Mahara for Mahala.
For these and other stories, visit our website www.263chat.com. Follow us on Twitter @263chat and like our Facebook page, 263chat.